us, why can't we find God?
Good evening, Calvary Chapel. Hello, family. How are you? I'm so excited to be in the Word with you this evening. It's the book of Isaiah is just absolutely amazing. And, you know, we were just praying a little bit before we started of just the how much we just, you know, it's not our power that we do these type of things when we teach, when we preach, and it has to be completely in the Spirit. And, and you know, to include reading His Word and how we approach the Lord, pretty amazing. Before we start in Isaiah chapter 17, let's go in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for your mercy and grace, Lord. Thank you for the ability to read your word, to be able to be in a country that allows us to freely have a Bible, freely be able to talk about you, to praise you, to glorify you in so many different ways, Lord. Lord, I pray that that everyone in this body, that they're protected, their marriages, their children, their families, their loved ones. Will you put a hedge of protection around each and every one of them, Lord? Just guide them, protect them, and give them clarity of mind when it comes to decisions and events that are happening during this COVID-19, Lord. We know you're on the throne and you have this, and we're just your humble servants, and we want to obey you, we want to surrender to you, and we want to praise you. And above all, we never want to take your glory. That is all yours. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen. Well, welcome again. So we are in Isaiah chapter 17. Title of this message, I call it Damascus Down. Being military, that seemed appropriate to me. Now you may recall last week we studied two chapters of, it was chapter 15 and 16 regarding Moab. And and essentially, I also ended that sermon last week in a discussion a little bit and in highlights about Psalm 83. And it's important to understand that we're in these next 10 or 12 chapters that are different nations, different cities. You know, Damascus is actually a city, but it's reference to Syria at that time, or the Assyria. And those nations, basically those land masses, are dual and sometimes triple prophecies. Sometimes near term to Isaiah, and clearly in the end times are going to be applied. And I talked about that a little bit, to where Psalm 83, much of Isaiah, Ezekiel 38, Ezekiel 39 are basically, they're tied together. They have pieces of them that provide that full picture, if you will, or that landscape of what you would need to fully understand the end times. And I say fully in what I mean by what you can read from the Word. There is so much about the end times that are not super, super clear, nor did the Holy Spirit give to us to know everything about it. But realize that as we go through this particular study in Damascus, chapter 17, that it will be, I hope it's enlightening and shows some of the prophetic items that happen near term to that, as well as in the future. So if I do my job this evening and I obey the Lord and allow Him to speak through me, I'm sure He's going to share how Damascus is in prophecy and why the demise of a nation or a city exists. You got to remember that throughout all of Isaiah, in Isaiah 1, when the Lord is coming to Israel, and what He's saying, let us reason. And you're dealing with a nation that has denied the Lord. All of these nations have denied the Lord, have not relied on Him fully. And I can't help but to think of when I think of our nation. You know, I look at the United States of America, and there's so many positives that we do for the world, but yet there's not one that's good. If we are not glorifying the Lord or living a life or making policies or doing the certain things associated with how we lead in a godly manner, then it's not in God's glory. It's not to His praise. It's not to His honor. And quite frankly, in many cases, many of the laws and things that we do are more evil in the sense of Baal worship, or something where we're worshiping the god of mammon, right? Money, you know, filthy lucre, as the Bible says. And there are numerous times throughout our lives as we are growing up in this culture, in this nation, that, you know, check this box, go here, do this, go to school, graduate, get a good job, keep getting promoted, do the best you can, be nice, go to church, do all these different things, like as if there's this perfect, you know, life that each of us are supposed to have, where, you know, we have a significant other, a husband or a wife, and we have two kids, we have a dog, white picket fence, nice house, a 401k, good job, kids enough to where the kids can go to college and all that. But it is way more than that. It is, I'm sure, in the time of Damascus and the time of Moab, that those families that were raising their kids had their own culture aspects of what was meant to be successful in life. Now, what I'm saying is, if we are not glorifying the Lord in our actions and how we do it, then we are just as bad as one of these other nations that where the Lord showed us in his Bible the judgment that will befall them. So with that being said, turn with me to Isaiah chapter 17. And if you were here, I'd say once you were there, please say amen. All right, so Isaiah chapter 17. It's only 14 verses. So what I'm going to do first is I'm going to read it. How about I do that? All right, so Isaiah chapter 17. The burden of Damascus. Behold, Damascus is taken away from being a city, and it shall be a ruinous heap. The cities of Aroer are forsaken. They shall be for flocks, which shall lie down, and none shall make them afraid. The fortress also shall cease from Ephraim, and the kingdom from Damascus, and the remnant of Syria. They shall be as the glory of the children of Israel, saith the Lord of hosts. And in that day it shall come to pass that the glory of Jacob shall be made thin, and the fatness of his flesh shall wax lean. And it shall be as when the harvestman gathereth the corn, and reapeth the ears with his arm, and it shall be as he that gathereth ears in the valley of Rephaim. Verse 6. Yet gleaning grapes shall be left in it, as the shaking of an olive tree, two or three berries in the top of the utmost bough, four or five in the outmost, fruitful branches thereof, saith the Lord God of Israel. At that day shall a man look to his maker, and his eyes shall have respect to the Holy One of Israel. And he shall not look to the altars, the work of his hands, neither shall respect that which his fingers have made, either the groves or the images. Verse 9. In that day shall his strong cities be as forsaken bough, and an uppermost branch, which they left because of the children of Israel. And there shall be desolation, because thou hast forgotten the God of thy salvation, and hast not been mindful of the rock of thy strength. Therefore shalt thou plant pleasant plants, and shalt set it with strange slips. In the day shalt thou make thy plant to grow, and in the morning shalt thou make thy seed to flourish. But the harvest shall be a heap in the day of grief and of desperate sorrow. Verse 12. Woe to the multitude of many people, which make a noise like the noise of the seas and the rushing of nations, that make a rushing like the rushing of mighty waters. The nations shall rush like the rushing of many waters, but God shall rebuke them, and they shall flee far off, and shall be chased as the chaff of the mountains before the wind, and like a rolling thing before the whirlwind. And behold, at eventide, trouble, and before the morning he is not. This is the portion of them that spoil us, and the lot of them that rob us. That is Isaiah chapter 17. So, Isaiah chapter 17, Damascus, right? So what is Damascus and where is it? Now we know Damascus is it's a city in Syria, right? In the country of Syria. It is considered one of the oldest cities on the planet. We can't really prove that, but from historical records, we believe it to be one of the oldest, if not the oldest. There is an old city section of Damascus that has not been harmed with all the war-torn region that is happening in the country of Syria. As we know, it's been for quite a long time now, for quite a few years, it's a lot of refugees and a lot of it's at war. It's really what it is, a civil war. And it's really, without going into a lot of detail, it's the Sunni versus Shiite Muslims and the different aspects of the nations that surround it, the allies, Our nation actually has people there supporting it. There's a confederacy, if you will, of Russia, Turkey, and Iran to withdraw Assad. That is relatively new. There's the forces of the army of Turkey has been on the outskirts of different aspects of Syria. Refugees all over the place fleeing the country. It used to be not too long ago that the city of Aleppo was the most populous city, but it is no longer. Damascus is the most populous city today because most of the population of Aleppo, or at least not the most, but many of the population have fled as refugees. Now, verse 1 through 3, what you have here is you have the burden or the prophecy of Damascus. And behold, it's look, take notice of what I'm telling you. This is extremely important, right? When you see the word behold. The city of Damascus is no longer. It shall be a ruinous heap. Now, in the history of what we know to be history, Damascus has never been a ruinous heap to where the old city has been destroyed completely. There's been many times where it's had battles and it's had issues where it's been conquered and taken and under a different kingdom. But it's never been ruinously destroyed. So we know that prophecy to be in the future. Now, the cities of Aor are forsaken. You may recall when we studied a little bit in Numbers when it was talking about the different cities of Moab, and Numbers 32:34 says this, "And the children of Gad built Dibon and Atarith and Aor, the kings," and basically those are that was under the children of Gad in that Moab area going up to the north. On the King's Highway, is you may hear that as a reference. The King's Highway on the east side of Jordan is a route that's been used for centuries that goes all the way up from the southern area of Dead Sea all the way up to Damascus and further north. Now, they are deserted. They're abandoned. Flocks will graze throughout the city is the concept. So the city has been destroyed so much that it's been abandoned to such a degree that now flocks are going to go there. It's one of those things where it's only a place for flocks to graze, if you will. They will be down undisturbed. No one there will frighten them away. So when you hear that, it's what that means is the flocks that are there aren't used to humans. They aren't used to mankind. And as we know, if any mankind's around, normally animals will flee. In this situation, they don't because they don't exist. It's deserted and abandoned. Now the fortress also shall cease from Ephraim. It is destroyed. Now the kingdom from Damascus ceases and the royal, you know, think of this as the royal power of Damascus. And we'll dive into that a little bit more. Now concerning the remnant of Syria, they shall be as the glory of the children of Israel, saith the Lord of hosts, of heavenly armies, right? Now you may recall weeks ago where we were in Isaiah chapter 7 and chapter 8. Now, what that subject was, if I can just recap just a teeny little bit here, is it's when the Lord gave Ahaz the ability or the opportunity to pick him to choose the Lord or not. And as we know, Ahaz did not choose the Lord. And then in chapter 8, the Lord went to the people of Judah, Jerusalem, to they also had the opportunity to choose the Lord over over the worldly decisions of Ahaz, and they did not as well. And you may also recall at that time where there was the king of Syria was Rezin, was his name, R-E-Z-I-N. And we had Pekah, the son of Remaliah, who was the king of Israel. So what you had at that particular time is you had the southern tribe, the southern kingdom and the northern kingdom. In the southern kingdom, you had two tribes, Benjamin and Judah. In the northern kingdom, you had the other 10. That was called Israel. So I don't want to confuse you with that when we talk about Israel today. In the past, it was split between the northern kingdom, the southern kingdom, and the northern kingdom was Israel. The leader of them at that time was Pekah, the son of Remaliah. So Rezin, the king of Assyria, and Pekah joined forces together to attempt to sack, invade Jerusalem, Judah. And in that particular time, it was basically to go to war with Jerusalem. And you may recall when Ahaz was besieged that he did not seek the Lord. And what he did is he went to Tilgath-Pileser, who was the Assyrian king at that time, and made a pact with him, right? And that was in 2 Kings 16, where Ahaz, the king of Judah, sent messengers to Tiglath-Pileser, king of Assyria, and he said three key things. And these three things are important because you see them all the time. He said, I am thy servant, and thy son, come save me, to the world. He was talking to Tiglath-Pileser. You would think those would be the things that he would say to the Lord, but he did not. He did not choose the Lord. Ahaz took the silver and gold from the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house, and he sent it for a present to the king of Assyria. Now the king of Assyria, because of this, basically just got paid, went up against Damascus. He took it, he slew Rezin, and he carried the people of it captive to Kir. Now you remember Kir from last week, which was one of the cities that we discussed as Ar. So Kir, K-I-R, which is Kirak of today, right? At this time, when all of this happened, this is around 730, 733 BC. So prophecy-wise, this is happening in the near future, what Isaiah is saying, as well as certain aspects happen later in time. Now, you may also recall when we talked about Kir, that it's modern-day Kirak, but listen to this. So King Ahaz went to Damascus to, and I'm going to paraphrase 2 Kings 16. It's a long, long section, but let me just paraphrase this a little bit so you can gather what's happening here. There throughout the Bible, there are numerous times where Damascus is mentioned that we should take note of, right? Now, we've talked about the fact that Jerusalem is the most mentioned city, then it's Babylon, and then it's Bethlehem, right? Well, then soon after that is Damascus, is one of the other highly mentioned cities, because it was part of what you would call the initial area that Abraham and Jacob went. Now, so this is kind of like Genesis type stuff here. When Abraham left Ur and went up through and followed the Euphrates, right? And most of the time, every time somebody traveled in the older times, they never went very far away from the water source. So they traveled the way of Euphrates and then came down from and just north of that area, call it Nineveh, call it that section, is Haran or Pana Aram, right? Which is, it's the same area where Jacob went and spent all that time when he was with Laban and raising the sheep and the cattle when he fled from his brother Esau. It's also the same place where, it's basically where Aram, where Abraham was his home base, if you will, right, of time. It's way up in Assyria, way north of Damascus, and it's near what you would call Hamath, Haran, those type of things, many different cities today, but just realize that we're talking the Euphrates River. If I kind of drew this a picture for you, it'd be something like this, right? Euphrates River goes up here, and then down comes all the way from the top of Euphrates, Damascus, then you're going to all the way down here, Jerusalem or the Sea of Galilee, the Dead Sea, and then here's the Med, right? And that's a terrible graphic. I totally get it, but work with me. The bottom line is, It's a little bit of a distance, right? If I gave you a distance from Babylon to Nineveh, you're talking 300 miles. So if you tilt that the other side, it's 300 miles, maybe 400. But they traveled this. They traveled this numerous times. And David's kingdom and Solomon's, when it was at its most advanced pushed as far as the landmass that they had, this entire area was part of the kingdom of Israel. And people get stuck with this. I get stuck with this, right? Because you think today where, well, that's Israel's this size and that's Syria and that's Damascus. That's definitely Syria. But at one time, under the ultimate size of the kingdom, it was under David's kingdom. There was garrisons there. It was all the way to the Euphrates River. And Solomon's was at the same way because he inherited that from his father David, right? So when you're thinking about biblical times, about certain aspects that are happening here, at this, when I just mentioned this piece where with the Assyrian conquering Damascus, of course it was not under that size, right? Because the Davidic kingdom, if you will, under David, was before the split of the northern and southern kingdom. So let me kind of just close the loop there on that. David has a kingdom. He gives it to his son when he dies. His son, when his son gives it to his son, Rehoboam, is when they split from the southern kingdom to the northern kingdom. But right before that, not very long before that, you're talking 40, 50 years, that was all part of the kingdom. All right, so I kind of beat that up a little bit, but it's important to know that this is the stomping ground of Abraham, of Jacob, of David. All right, so 2 Kings 16. King Ahaz went to Damascus to meet Tiglath-Pileser, king of Assyria. This is after he defeated Rezin and Pekah, the son of Remaliah. So now it's like they're buddies, right? So he goes, so Ahaz travels to Damascus to meet Tiglath-Pileser, the king of Assyria. He sees an altar there in Damascus, and he sent for Uriah, his priest. So Ahaz, the king of Jerusalem, a king of Judah, sent for his priest to come there to fashion the same altar. Now imagine this. Now he's already chosen not to follow the Lord. Now he's choosing that he's going to get an altar that is for pagan worship, right? That's really essentially what it is. So Uriah the priest built an altar according to all that King Ahaz had sent from Damascus. When the king was done there, he left Damascus, went to Jerusalem, and the king saw the altar, and the king approached the altar and offered thereon. He chose that altar over the guidance of what altar that he's supposed to use. The story goes on and on about what he did, where he moved the altar. He actually put it in the temple court and actually gave offerings on that evil altar that was not of the making of the Lord. And you can assume and know just from this conversation that that is just a wrong thing to do and very typical of just Ahaz's downfall of how he goes. And it goes later on in verse 18, it says, and the covert for the Sabbath that they built in the house and the king's entry without turned he from the house of the Lord for the king of Assyria. Now what that means is he turned from the house of the Lord to the king of Assyria. He turned his back on God. Pretty significant thing that Damascus comes into play in when it comes to Israel. Now, Jeremiah, many years later, prophesied about Damascus. And this is a proof text associated with why the destruction of Damascus, just another proof text, why Damascus wasn't destroyed at the time of Assyria. That's what it means, right? If Jeremiah, who's, 100 years later after this event, he's the prophet that's prophesying during Judah and Jerusalem being taken captive by Nebuchadnezzar to Babylon, right? So you're talking much, much later in time. So we know that Damascus was still around at that particular time. We know it's still around today. But every once in a while, you may get somebody, depending on how they read the Bible, that they will say that this prophecy has been fulfilled, and that is not true. At least not as according to how I read the Bible and many others. Now, according to the prophet Jeremiah, the destruction of Damascus begins at Hamah and Arpad. Now, those are two cities north of Damascus. Now, many would say that we're on the brink of tribulation today. As I mentioned to you earlier, Turkey has their armies that are very close to that particular area. There are also, depending on what your eschatology is on end times, different beliefs on what the timing of the tribulation and those type of things. For us, we believe that there is no event that's waiting to happen except for the rapture. We don't know when that's going to happen, but there's no timed event that we are waiting on. The rapture is our next event if you are saved. If you're not saved, then there's all kinds of other things that can happen. The Battle of Damascus could happen beforehand, the tribulation of the 7 years, second coming of the Lord, that entire thing is has a lot in it. Do we know exactly when that battle of Damascus being destroyed is during that time frame? No. But I'm a Christian. You're a Christian. You're not going to be here for that. Right, so spending a lot of time on when that's going to be destroyed isn't going to carry much weight for you. I mean, unless you just want the knowledge of what it is, and maybe the Lord will give you a gleaning for it. A lot of people study end times prophecy for a lot of different reasons because you want to be able to share, because you're trying to explain to people how destructive the end times is. It is full of death, torment, and so many other things, and you would want to avoid that, right? You don't want to go to hell, or you don't want to deal with that type of thing. I mean, because it's destructive, and it comes with a lot of pain and just complete horrors all over the place. Excuse me. Anyway, so moving on from that. So at this particular time, those cities of Hamath and Arpad that are north of Damascus, the armies of Turkey are right near there. So there's certain aspects where that when you read Jeremiah 49, and I'm going to give you a couple verses because I want to tie this together just a little bit. So Jeremiah 49, 23 to 27, it says this, "Concerning Damascus, Hamath is confounded, and Arpad, for they have heard evil tidings. They are faint-hearted. There is sorrow on the sea. It cannot be quiet. Damascus is waxed feeble, and turneth herself to flee. And fear hath seized on her. Anguish and sorrows have taken her, as a woman in travail. How is this the city of praise not left, the city of my joy? Therefore her young men shall fall in her streets, and all the men of war shall be cut off in that day, saith the Lord of hosts. And I will kindle a fire in the wall of Damascus, and it shall consume the palaces of Ben-Hadad." So what you see there, depending on your prophecy studies and different aspects of when the timing is of the destruction of Damascus, you're on the verge of this. We are completely on the verge of this, or at least a gleaning of a picture of it. If you know many of the events that have happened worldwide when it comes to Turkey and where they are and what they're doing, they're not on the same side. This destruction, this rumor of wars and these type of things are very, very they're very real. If you have not, I guess what I mean is, there are many Christians and many people turning to Christ inside of Syria, and the destruction and the war-torn region has had a major impact on everybody's life there. And it's been really, really bad. There's been times where I've listened to different speakers associated who have been from there, where they've discussed just how bad it is. But they always say a couple of things about the people that are turning to the Lord is growing day after day. But it's pretty heavy, right? But Hamath and those two cities, they're right near this situation that's happening with battles that have been going on over time. So as far as current events and news, I don't know what to tell you there. I would just look up on that if you want to look into that. But realize that at no time, the way it is that we see today, are all these nations aligned? They've never been aligned the way they are today. You know, there's a lot of end times prophecies being fulfilled daily that are very, very good pictures of the future. Now, Damascus is, like I said, is perhaps the oldest continuous inhabited city in the world. Never been destroyed by warfare. It is the capital of Syria, as I said, as well. And it's currently, and this is the one current event that I think is prevalent, a total of 7 of the foreign terrorist organizations on the State Department's terrorism list are headquartered in Damascus. 7. It's pretty volatile area. All right, moving on to verse 4 and 6. So, "And in that day it shall come to pass that the glory of Jacob shall be made thin," he'll shrink, "and the fatness of the flesh shall be waxed lean," right? They're starving. They're not being filled. "And it shall be when the harvestman gathered the corn and reapeth the ear with his arm." The land is stripped, essentially. Nothing to harvest. It's desolate. "Like the fields after the harvest, like the valley of Rephaim," right? Now, Valley of Rephaim is, if you recall that, is, you know the story of David when he slew Goliath, right? That was at the Valley of Elah. Well, the Valley of Rephaim is just west of Jerusalem, Bethlehem area. But it was always the area that David would go to battle to the Philistines. So numerous times in the Bible, you hear that the Philistines are arrayed in the Valley of Rephaim, right? And David, when he became king, was defeating the Philistines there. Very prevalent area. But it was a harvest area. It was a field. It was not a field, but it was a flat area to where crops and things could be grown. And it's gleaned. There's nothing there. Yet gleaning grapes shall be left in it as the shaking of an olive tree. Two or three berries in the top of the utmost bough. Four or five in the utmost fruitful branches thereof, saith the Lord of Israel. So verse 7 and 9. And at that day shall a man look to his maker. They will turn to their creator, and his eyes shall have respect to the Holy One of Israel. And he shall not look to the altars, the work of his hands, neither shall respect that which his fingers have made. So they're no longer looking to their idols, no, their groves or their images, you know, their Ashtoreth poles, their pagan shrines. None of that type of stuff is going to answer the mail for them for salvation. In that day, his strong cities be as forsaken bough, an uppermost branch, like a deserted forest, if you will, right? Which they left because of the children of Israel, and there shall be desolation. Verse 10 and 11. Because thou hast forgotten the gods of thy salvation, and hast not been mindful of the rock of thy strength. Now, the rock of my strength. Now, we know who that is, right? That's Jesus. Jesus is our rock. Jesus is our rock, our cornerstone. He is our life, the truth. He is everything associated with God's plan for redemption for us, for salvation, for redemption, for sanctification, and onward onto the entire process of going to have eternal life and living eternity with God. That's the entire plan. When you think of a rock, when you think of many parables associated with the Bible, when Jesus spoke to us, he talked about the house that was on a firm foundation, on the rock, not on shifting sand. The concept of rock, right, if you just think about it, I mean, he keeps it very simple, is the fact that I am firm, I am solid, I am unmovable, I am a defense, I am so many different things associated where you can rely on God, on Jesus, to be that refuge, to be that protection for anything that is coming our way. Now, we will be tested. Our faith will have its testings and its trials, not tribulation in the sense of the seven-year tribulation, but definitely some form of tribulation to deal with a particular situation, to deal with a particular event in our lives, and how we react to that event and how we glorify the Lord in that event is honoring to the Lord. It's part of our testing. It's part of our growth in sanctification, in becoming Christ-like and allowing Jesus to work through us. He will never give us more than we can handle. He makes it very clear with that. But here, they don't turn to the rock. They're not focused on the rock of salvation. And he says, but thou hast forgotten the God of thy salvation, has not been mindful of the rock of thy strength. I mean, think about that. I mean, we learn from Ahaz and throughout the Bible, and I mean, week after week after week, we talk about somebody that had the opportunity to turn to the Lord, or a nation, a country, a city, and they choose not to. They want to do it in their own worldly power. And, you know, I started off this sermon with talking about our own country, right? Look at it now. I mean, how many people, how many politicians or leadership people, I mean, kind of difficult to lead if you're not being godly led. So I don't know if that's true leadership or not. I guess it's just direction of somebody following that's ungodly. So I guess that can be form of leadership, but you know, there's a lot of self-help books and professional advancement and professional development, if you will, on how to be a leader. But God gives us that guidance of how to be a leader, and He is the ultimate leader. But bottom line is, throughout this, Damascus does not turn to the Lord, denied the Lord. Syria, Israel, different aspects of that. Now, here's an interesting piece in this particular scripture where it says, in that day shalt, and I'm on verse 11, in the day shalt thou make thy plant to grow, and in the morning thou shalt make thy seed to flourish, but the harvest shall be a heap in the day of grief and desperate sorrow. Now, right before that, you may notice where it said, in verse 10, therefore shalt thou plant pleasant plants, and shalt set it with strange slips. So it's talking about this plant. Well, that pleasant plant, where it says, thou plant pleasant plants, that word pleasant This is the only time that word appears in the King James Bible. And it is fascinating, right? Do you know what the word is? It is Naaman. N-A-A-M-A-N. Naaman. Now, as a word of a pleasant, right? But we know that there is somebody else that's actually named Naaman in the Bible. And what the Lord is showing us here, I consider this to be just amazing section of scripture, because we're talking about a Gentile nation. We're talking about an area of the world that is not focused on the Lord. We're talking about people that are worshiping idols, and they're not worshiping the God of Israel. So now, 2 Kings 5, and I'm going to paraphrase this as well. So 2 Kings 5, the entire chapter is about naming the captain of the hosts of the king of Assyria. But listen to this in a narrative version. Naaman, captain of the host of the king of Syria, a great man with his master, and honorable. He was a mighty man of valor, but he was a leper, right? And he had brought away captive out of the land of Israel a little maid. So in his intrusions into Israel, they brought back people. And he brought back an Israel, a little maid, a female maid. And she waited on Naaman's wife. She said unto her mistress, "Would God, my Lord, were with the prophet that is in Samaria." So what she's saying is, Naaman has leprosy, but if he was with the prophet in Samaria, he would heal him, right? So he would recover him of his leprosy. The maid that is of the land of Israel said this. Now the king of Syria, once he told him, said, go to Israel. I'll send a letter to the king of Israel. And he did. So he departed and he went. And he sent Naaman, in that letter, he says, "I send Naaman, my servant, to you so that you can recover him from his leprosy." The king of Israel reads the letter and rents his clothes and basically says, "What am I, God? I can't heal leprosy. I can't save people." And he's afraid, right? Because the Syria has already invaded the nation to a little bit. Now if I don't heal his general, what's going to happen, right? And that's conjecture, but realize he is afraid of this situation. Now, once he rents his clothes, Elijah, the man of God, had heard that the king of Israel rent his clothes. And he went and saw him, and he said, "Let him come on to me." So Elijah says, "Hey, send Naaman to me." So Elijah sends a messenger on to him, and this is what he says to him. "Go and wash in the Jordan 7 times. And that's all he says. Naaman, right, this honorable general, if you will, is so wroth, so upset, so aggravated, he gets angry, and he's in pride, complete pride. He goes, "I thought he would surely come out to me," and, you know, basically tell him to do something or whatever the case may be. And he says, "Aren't the rivers of Damascus better than the waters of Israel?" This is him talking to his servant. And his servant says, he turned away in rage, just completely angry that he wanted him to go wash in the Jordan 7 times. And his servants came near and spake unto him. He said, "If the prophet had bid thee to do some great thing, some great battle or something like that, you would have done it," is what he tells him. And he said, "You know what? You're right." And he goes down, dips himself 7 times in the Jordan and in the Jordan River. And his flesh came clean like unto a flesh of a little child, and he was clean. And he returned to the man of God, to Elijah. And he says, "Now," this is key to the entire thing. He says, "Now I know that there is no God in all the earth but in Israel." Now realize, he is the general, the honorable man of the king of Syria, who they worship all kinds of other pagan gods. But now that he's healed, he knows exactly who that is. And he says, "Now I know that there is no God in all of the earth but in Israel." And he says, "Take a blessing to my servant." So he wanted to pay Elijah for this. And Elijah refused to take it. And he said, just told him to go in peace. And my master has spared Naaman the Syrian. It's an incredible story, right? And it's so much more detail of it than what I just described. But realize what just happened here. A Gentile has been made clean. And a Gentile who, you know, through the godly, divine intervention, if you will, he goes into Israel, happens to get a maid that believes that the prophet will be able to save him from his leprosy. The king goes to the king of Israel, and the king of Israel doesn't even believe, right? He doesn't, I mean, the prophet is the one that interjects himself when the king rents his clothes. You know, this is very similar to a Gentile being grafted into to Christianity that we are today, or have been ever since Israel denied Jesus Christ. There's not many times where a Gentile in the Old Testament is believes in God. And when they do believe in God, the Holy Spirit makes it very clear to us that they are a Gentile and they believe in God. You have to take note of that, because it's really important. Because you remember, all the way up until Paul, Gentiles, that's not your God, that's our God. Everybody else worships somebody else. Pretty powerful stuff. Verse 12 and 13, Isaiah 17. It says, "Woe to the multitudes of my many people, the armies of many nations, which make noise like the noise of the seas." So think of rushing of nations that make a rushing like the rushing of mighty waters. "They shall rush like the rushing of many waters, but God shall rebuke them." God will silence the army, right? So we know as the army that they had at that particular time clearly lost to Assyria, and whatever army is going to exist there in the future will be silenced as well. It will be chased as chaff of the mountain before the wind, and like the rolling thing before the whirlwind, like a tumbleweed, right? Verse 14, "And behold, an evening time trouble, and before the morning he is not. By dawn its enemies are dead. This is the portion of them that spoil us, and that lot of them that rob us." Now, let's tie this together a little bit with the New Testament. I'm sure by now, as throughout this sermon, as you've listened to how many times I've mentioned Damascus, you had to say to yourself, "I know a time about Damascus." What about Paul, his Damascus moment, right? So I'm going to paraphrase that for you as well. So Saul, who became Paul, now picture this. Now, before the Gentiles, before you and I were even able to become Christians, there was a situation where Stephen, the first martyr, where Saul was basically, they stoned Stephen to death, right? And Stephen allowed it and asked the Lord to forgive them, for they did not know what they were doing. And he looked up, and you see this awesome, awesome section of scripture in Acts 7 and 8, where he sees heaven, where he sees, and he's just happy. He's being stoned, and he's happy. Pretty amazing. But Saul, who was, you know, he was from the tribe of Benjamin, he was studied under Gamaliel, he was just the Hebrew of Hebrews, right? Prior to him being saved. And I want to talk about his Damascus Road moment, because it's another example where we're seeing the Lord use Damascus to point us to salvation, just like in this section of scripture. So Saul, when he went to the high priest, he asked the high priest, and he desired a letter from him, said, "Hey, send me to Damascus, to the synagogues. And then that way I can find all these Christians or these people that are in the way," is what it says. And whether they be men or women, "I'm going to bring them back bound and tied to the city of Jerusalem, and we're going to deal with them." Now, clearly, he just dealt with Stephen by stoning, so I guess that's what they're going to do, but it doesn't say that. They're going to do something similar, because that's what Stephen was. Now, he came near Damascus, and a light from heaven came, and he fell to the earth. And he heard a voice saying on him, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" And he said, "Who art thou, Lord?" And the Lord said, "I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks." And he trembled and astonished, and the Lord, "What wilt thou have me do?" So imagine this. Now here you have, up until this point, Saul believed, just like the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and everyone before him, that they were doing the right thing, that they were following exactly what the Lord wanted. They just were wrong. They were completely wrong with it, just like Nicodemus when he went and visited Jesus in the middle of the night. You have to be born again. But as soon as he sees Jesus, this event was so big that he said, "What would you have me, Lord? What wilt thou have me do?" And the Lord said, "Arise and go into the city," Damascus, right? "And the men which journeyed with him stood speechless. They heard a voice, but they saw no man. And they went, and Saul went there, and he was there for 3 days without sight." And he blinded him. "Neither did he eat nor drink." Now, at this time, the Lord contacts somebody named Ananias. And he says, Ananias, arise and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire into the house of Judas for the one called Saul of Tarsus. So he prayed. He's like, Lord, I heard some bad stuff about Saul. You sure this is what you want? You know, this is a really good, a small portion of scripture, but a great example of the Lord giving an insight or a gleaning or direction to one of his servants, and he can obey or not. And he obeyed, right? It's kind of just like with us as Christians, right? When you're sure that the Lord's speaking to you and you're supposed to go do something, I highly recommend you go do it. And I pray that you will do it just like I would do it. But Ananias here, this is pretty tough, right? This guy's killing people. Last report was Stephen just got stoned. All right, Lord, in faith, I'm going to do exactly what you want me to do. So he does. So he goes into Damascus, finds the place where Saul is, and he says, go thy way, for he tells Ananias, go thy way, for he is my chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles. Now, isn't that interesting? Before the Gentiles. So when you look at the bookends of certain things that the Lord is showing us about Damascus, he heals Naaman, a Gentile from Damascus, and Paul is going to Damascus, and Paul is getting the mission that he's going to tell the Gentiles exactly who and what they are to be, right? Because this is what's so just fascinating about this. The Battle of Damascus in the end times, this particular section of Scripture, saved people are not here. We're not dealing with this. We're up in heaven, right? Gentiles, that's where we are. And then, you know, much deeper than that, but that's what's going on. So Ananias goes there, and he sees him. He says, thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. Immediately there fell from his eyes as if it had been scales, and he received his sight, and he arose, and he was baptized. And from there, he ate because he regained his strength, and straightway he preached Christ in the synagogues that he was the Son of God. Now, imagine this. You have the Jew, the Hebrew of Hebrews, who does not believe Jesus is God, right? Going into the synagogues, and he's now going to go 180 out of where he has been, and he has turned to God. The exact same thing God has been telling everybody to do all through Isaiah, turn to me. Don't turn to them. Don't turn to the world. Don't believe in what you believe. Turn to me. And the Lord shows us in Paul. Shows us on the road to Damascus, that's exactly what he had Paul do. And we know that throughout the Bible, throughout the New Testament, there are many times where Paul talks about different things associated with the mysteries of the Lord and what the Lord shows him and all kinds of different things. But what I want to talk about as we end here in these last 10 minutes is the fact that when we're saved, when Paul was saved, right? This is a Damascus moment, right? This is the light, Jesus speaking. That's not the way it is for everybody, right? Each and every person that's saved has probably a completely different, we all have a completely different story of what that was, of when the Lord spoke to our heart, when we realized that wherever we were was not the right way to go, and we chose to embrace, to live a life towards God and accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior. And when you think of, you know, the gospel and the fact that the Lord came, died for everybody's sin, was buried and was up on the cross, died, was buried and resurrected 3 days later in the right hand of the Father, right? That is the gospel in itself. The aspect of salvation and turning to the Lord is believing on the fact that he came to do that, having faith in that. Now, you may hear many different things where it says, repent, turn from your sins, ask the Lord into your heart. Those are all very accurate in the aspect of it. And I think when you think of your own situation of when you were saved and how you were saved and the timing of that, I'm sure you can talk about where you were. It may have been a valley of your life, a cry for desperation, where you just needed to latch onto the rock. You know, I always, being in the Navy, there's this famous painting, and I don't know what it's called, but it's this cross that's on this rock in this raging sea, and you just see somebody hanging on to the rock. It's pretty fascinating when you think about it. But that's what it is. That's when in our miry muck of where we were prior to being saved, and many of us probably didn't know we were in that muck. This world is muck. It is mud. It is nasty. If we could have a visual of living in this world without Christ, it would be a slime pit. It would be tar and black and ugly in so many different ways. And all too often, the world tries to blind us, just like Paul was blinded, with the fact that this world is great. It's wonderful. It's, you know, you can do this. You can do these great things. But you're never fulfilled. You know, if you read the book of Ecclesiastes and it discusses about, you know, vanity of vanity, there's nothing new under the sun. Over and over again, the wisest man that the Lord created, barring Jesus, he studied this. He studied man's behavior. He studied everything associated with it and it could never be fulfilled. And he ended up turning to some bad things. The point being, for those of you that are saved, you know exactly what the Lord saved you from. You know where you were, you know where you are today, and anytime you think about it, anytime you pause to reflect, to just be thankful and give praise to the Lord, you find yourself maybe even tearing up or just thinking, man, Lord, what you did for me, nobody can understand what he did for you. Nobody can understand what he did for me. And that is very different for everybody. Now, if you're not saved, you know, you may be thinking, okay, I hear you, Chris. This is good stuff, great, you know, but this professional development stuff is actually working for me. I'm doing pretty good. Got a pay raise. My job's great, right? And all of that's fine. You know, I would tell you this. I would say, pick anybody. Pick anybody that you consider successful of what, and if you truly knew every aspect of their life. I always like talking about guys like Tiger Woods and, you know, just different people that dealt with some crisis in their life. And yeah, great golfer, Lord gave him all kinds of talents, but he had his valley in numerous times. And just like many other people have, there's always searching for some form of filling a void that just doesn't come easy. You know, it's amazing how many stories you hear about, you know, what we consider to be the successful people, the super rich, the super wealthy, how they're just never seem to be happy. You know, multiple relationships, multiple drug situations, multiple alcohol situations, multiple all kinds of stuff. And it just becomes this endless grind of something. You know, another one too is people seeking money, right? I mean, Warren Buffett has a lot of money. You would think he'd retire. I'm just saying. I mean, how's he gonna spend it? It's never enough. That's what the trick of Satan is. Whether you save up $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, well, you can get 45. You can get 50, 60, 70, on and on and on again. Any type of distraction, any type of event that can make you turn away from the Lord. But over and over again, throughout Isaiah, throughout the Bible, he shows us all these different times where those valleys are going to come. And the Lord's going to give each and every person the opportunity somewhere in their life to pick him or not. And if you're a Christian, of course, you've already chosen him. And part of our job at being Christians is to allow that light to shine to where the people that are not saved understand exactly what they're being saved from. So what are you being saved from? You're being saved from the fact that what you do here today, this is not your best life. This is not where you're going to live and be happy and be merry and then have eternal life. At the end of this life, in this soul, if you will, this is the time where the Lord has given each and every one of us the opportunity to choose him or not. If you don't choose him, you're going to go to hell and at the white throne judgment where you did not choose the Lord. It's really as simple as that. It's eternal life with the Lord or hell. So you're being saved from hell. That's what we're being saved from when we choose him. Now, of course, as once you're a Christian, you understand that you're not thinking of hell anymore. You're thinking about the fact that how you can honor the Lord, how you can glorify Him, how you can allow His light to shine in your life so other people can see Him. Because when you're saved, you don't fear death anymore. You have such a peace and you have such a joy that it's so undescribable. When you deal with certain crises, you realize, all right, Lord, I know You're here with me. Let's get to it and get through it. What do You want me to do? What do You want me to learn? How do You want me to handle this? And what is so amazing throughout every single one of those events, there are so many other people watching you go through that crisis, watching me go through that crisis, and want to know how we are handling that. You know, this COVID thing, I'll tell you, it is such, as bad as it is such an incredible opportunity for us. And it continues to be. It continues to be one of these situations where numerous times I've heard so many stories of just the calmness of it. There is a lot of people freaking out with high level of anxiety. And I'm not judging them for how they deal with this situation or how it may be impacting their family. I'm sure there are many, many, many people dealing with crisis, dealing with death, dealing with sorrow, and dealing with all those type of things. But I can guarantee you this. If there is a Christian near that family that's dealing with those sorrows, they are helping them. And if there's those families that are not, that are dealing with those same situations, and there is no Christians or people that can help them through that or show them the light of Jesus, we need to pray for them, because they are that is a bad, bad place to be. And you get what I'm saying. I'm sure you do. But this is one of these opportunities where we get to share. Now, soon we'll be our state starts the regather process, and I cannot wait to see all of you when we come back. I mean, what a joy it is to be able to just see each other again, to hear the laughter, to hear the conversations, to hear how we've been dealing with certain aspects of it. And I long for that day, and I think I know Pastor Tom is pretty excited when that day comes, because it's going to be one of those, it's going to be another one of those joys that Christians share in, of just how much they love Jesus. And I'm sure there's going to be so many incredible stories of how Jesus showed Himself during this crisis in each of our lives. So with that, let's go in prayer. And that is Damascus Down. Heavenly Father, thank You for Your mercy and grace. Lord, thank You for this. Man, it's Your word is so, so awesome. It's just an absolute joy to study it, to read it, to share it, to talk about it. And know everywhere in Scripture, You show us You. You show us You all the time. And it is, you know, even in the most obscure places, you know, Naaman, I mean, Damascus. I mean, it's that amazes me and blows me away, Lord, that You allow us to have these nuggets and these treasures that you just make it so exciting. And always, always, there's the picture of You. Lord, I pray that we live a life that honors You, that we do everything we can to seek You, to fall on our knees, to pray to You, and to just give You glory at every turn in every day of our lives. Lord, we love You. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Have a good night, everyone.